All right, so we've already met the triangle method, and a triangle method is very useful when we're dealing with quite straightforward equations. Things like F equals ma or W equals mg, where one quantity is equal to some other quantities multiplied together. Even slightly more complex ones, like gravitational potential energy equals height times mass times gravity. But what we need is an approach that will work when things are slightly more complicated than that. And for that, I created the square method. And the square method was something that I created to help my students quickly and accurately rearrange more complicated formula. So let's look at an example. Let's look at the equation for power in a transformer. Power in equals power out. Current times voltage in equals current times voltage out. So that's I1 times V1 equals I2 times V2. Now, traditionally, suppose I wanted V2. What I would do is I would take I1 times V1 equals I2 times V2, and I would divide both sides by I2. That would give me I1 times V1 divided by I2 equals I2 times V2 divided by I2. And of course, I2 divided by I2 is 1. So that would tell me then that V2 equals I1 times V1 divided by I2. The square method is a little bit more straightforward than that. It only has two rules. And the rules are nice and straightforward. So first of all, what we would do is we would take the two equations that are written as equal to each other. So I1 times V1 equals I2 times V2. And we would put them on different lines of a square. So we'd have I1 V1 on the top, then we would have a line across the square, and I2 V2 at the bottom. Okay, so here are the two rules for using the equation square. Rule number one, if anything else is added to or subtracted from the quantity you're interested in, change the sign, change the line. So, change the sign of whatever's added to or subtracted from it and put it on the other line. The second rule, if the quantity you want is on the top, flip the square upside down so it's on the bottom. And that's it. After that, it's exactly the same as a triangle. You cover over the quantity you're interested in, and that immediately gives you the equation you need to use to find it. So let's look at our example. I have I1 times V1 on top of the square, I2 times V2 on the bottom of the square. Well, suppose I want to find V2. Let's look at it. Rule number one, is anything else added to or subtracted from it? No, it's just multiplied through by I2. Okay, rule number two, is it on the top of the square? Nope, in which case, I'm good to go. All I do is cover it over, and it immediately gives me the equation I need to use. V2 equals I1 times V1 divided by I2. So let's look at the other possibility. Let's say I wanted to find I1. Let's follow our rules and see what equation we have to use. So if I want to find I1, rule number one, is anything else added to or subtracted from it? Nope, it's just multiplied by V1. All right, is it on the top of the square? Rule two, yes. Flip it upside down. So flip the whole square upside down. And then, same as a triangle, cover over I1, and it will immediately tell you the equation you need to use. I1 equals I2 times V2 divided by V1. Now, not all equations are that simple. Some get much more complex, but this approach works just as easily for them as it does for everything else. So let's look at momentum. Momentum, when we're dealing with two objects that collide together and then stick together. All right, so under these circumstances, and in fact under all circumstances, momentum before equals momentum after for any closed system. So what does that mean? Well, as they stick together, we have mf times vf, final mass times the final velocity, will be equal to m1 times v1 plus m2 times v2. So the final momentum will be equal to the individual initial momentums added together. Okay, So as before, what we do is we take those separate parts of the equation and put them on different lines of the equation square. So suppose I wanted to find the final velocity, Vf. Let's look at my two rules. Rule number one, is anything else added to or subtracted from it? No. Rule number two, is it on the top of the square? Yes, it is. So flip the square upside down. And once you've done that, all you have to do is cover over. So cover over Vf, and that will give you Vf equals M1 times V1 plus M2 times V2 divided by Mf. All right, so let's try a more complex one. Let's look at finding V1. So, let's follow our two rules. Rule number one, is anything else added to or subtracted from it? And the answer is yes. We have M1 times V1 plus M2 times V2, so we have plus M2 times V2. So rule number one, change the sign, change the line. That M2 times V2 becomes negative and goes on to the other line. So now, what I have for my square is I have Mf times Vf minus M2 times V2. And now, is it on the top of the square? Nope, it's on the bottom. So my rule number two, I don't need to worry about. Immediately, I can just cover it over. I want to find V1, cover it over. V1 equals Mf times Vf minus M2 times V2, all divided by M1. And there we go. A much more complex example, very easy to solve by using the square and our two rules. So we apply our two rules and the answer comes out easily. Rule number one, change the sign, change the line. Rule number two, if it's on the top, flip the square upside down. And that's it, there's nothing else to it. Well done.